May is National Mental Health Awareness Month, and JFS, Jewish Family Services, and Tara's Closet have joined together to start a conversation to end the stigma of mental health. Over 25% of adults suffer with mental health. That makes mental health issues the number one cause of disability in the workplace. Now that's a big number. Today we're talking to three women who are doing something about this. My name is Pat Kazikoff. Stay with me, and we're going to find out what these women are doing to end the stigma of mental health. So I'm speaking to Janice Rothstein, and you are the Director of Clinical Services for JFS.
Yes.
And Kim Margolis, you are the
Director of Development at JFS.
And Risa Sugarman, who is a mother, a blogger, a writer, I understand, and also is coming out in public with her struggles, with your struggles with depression.
Yes.
So let's start with Janice. So this mental health issue, I mean, we know that a lot of people have it, and I know the words depression, and I know the words bipolar disease, but what else is included in that bailiwick?
That's a very good question. Mental health illness, there's at least 200 different forms of mental illness.
So what's the big ones?
Depression, anxiety, bipolar disorder, schizophrenia, to name just a few.
Addiction is included in that?
Addiction can be part of someone's condition, yes.
So what are the big symptoms? What are the big symptoms of mental illness?
Okay. Well, first, mental illness is a change, a significant change in thinking, emotion, and ability to function, a significant change.
So somebody like me or somebody like anybody here, we all have significant changes. What do those significant changes look like?
And there's a group of changes. It's not just one factor. Some of the factors include changes in sleep, changes in eating, changes in activity. Someone who was very active and loved to be with their friends, their guy friends, their girlfriends, and do whatever activity, they stop doing those things. They become more isolated. Sometimes they're more paranoid. Sometimes they have a hard time figuring out what they should be doing. Their insight changes.
So somebody, everything you're saying, a change in sleep, a change in eating habits, I mean, everybody has that. That's nobody who doesn't have that.
Absolutely.
So how does it get to, what's the fine line between my not being able to sleep, my not being able to get up in the morning, my not wanting to be with my friends? What's the fine line that makes it an illness?
It's the severity, it's the duration, and it's how it impacts your functioning, your day-to-day functioning.
So would you know by looking at somebody? Could you tell?
Not just by looking at someone, no.
So Risa, you have come forward, and it's a heroic thing to do, to say that you have depression. Based on what Janice is saying, did you have the insight, like, did you know this is an illness, or did you think, well, I just can't get up in the morning?
In the beginning, in my adolescent years, I just thought this was how everyone was. And as things progressed, I would then begin to recognize, no, this isn't normal. With each episode of depression that I've had, the very early stages, I don't have the insight to see that something is going on. People around me who are very close to me, my husband, for example, they recognize it and then will say, we got to go do something about this before it gets worse.
So there is some sort of, is there a cataclysmic event?
Not necessarily. One of my major episodes was preceded by fertility treatments, so there was a lot of hormones involved, and that kind of may have sparked something that led to that depression. My most recent episode, there was really no event that warranted, you know, a major depressive episode.
So Janice, as a clinical person, most people have a cataclysmic event or no?
Not necessarily.
So her experience is common.
I think that there are many, it's really individualized. And so for some, it's a major event. And for others, it's a lifelong condition.
It's a struggle.
Yes.
And what about Kim? We talked right at the beginning that Tara's Closet was joining with JFS. Mm-hmm. What exactly is Tara's Closet?
Tara's Closet is a new program at Jewish Family Services. It was founded by Barbara Roth in honor of her daughter's memory, Tara Savin, who was a young, bright woman in our community who suffered from bipolar disorder. And she had a passion for fashion and received her social work degree at Fordham University. And she was a true humanitarian. And in 2010, she lost her life to mental illness. So Barbara founded this closet in her honor, and it serves two purposes. The first one is to provide clothing to men, women, and children in our community who are in need, whether they're short-term or long-term needs, in a boutique-style environment setting where members of the community can come and try on clothes and feel good inside and look good on the outside.
Sounds like a fun thing to do.
Yeah, it's at no cost, and it's
can anybody
anyone
go?
In the community. It's open to everyone in the community who is in need.
And do you have to show that you're in need?
No.
No. So it's
self-identified. If you are struggling and you are in need, then you can come and make an appointment. It's by appointment only. It's a boutique-style setting, so you come, you try on the clothes like you were entering a department store.
Wow.
So you go, there's a fitting room, you try on the clothes, you come out, you show
everyone.
So it's
very elegant.
Yes, it's set up like you're in a department store.
Wow.
To give everyone the opportunity to shop. And that's the obvious purpose of Tara's Closet. But there's another goal, is to raise awareness and education on mental illness in our community.
You know, I'm having a problem. I'm listening to you, and you're describing this young woman, and you're saying she was bright, and she went to Fordham University, and that she graduated, and that she worked. How does that work? How does a person with depression, how are they so highly functional? How does that happen? Risa or Janice, give me some insight here.
Well, when I first heard about Tara herself, we have a lot of similarities. I also got my master's in social work at Fordham.
Well, you just gave me the chills.
I have always been successful in education and then professionally. I am very blessed. I have an amazing family, close family, amazing friends. And I think for me, I didn't even know that I was putting on this face. It just became part of it. Like, don't let anybody know what I'm feeling inside.
Did you know that you had an illness? Were you that conscious?
Not in the beginning. Not in the beginning. It was really in college when I recognized it. But you know, there is a stigma, and so you kind of, I was almost as if I was reared that way. That, well, don't let anyone know, because what are people gonna say? And it just got to a point where I said, why am I hiding?
Right.
I'm not going to hide, and I'm getting help, and that's important.
So Janice, is that a common story? A person who is bright, who's educated, who's professional, and who's highly functional. Like, does that make sense?
Yeah. Yes.
That makes sense.
There certainly, it's not uncommon. Stories such as yours to have lived with it and be able to get help and have a very functional life with support from family. Those who choose not to come forward have a much more difficult time.
But can they go on ad infinitum with this level of performance? Like, at a certain point, does it not break down? Lisa?
It did for me. Yeah. It did for me 2.5 years ago, 3 years ago. It just got to a point where I was trying to be superwoman, be a good mom, be a good wife, work full time, and everything kind of shattered. I couldn't do it anymore. And
what does that look like? When a person says, I couldn't do it anymore, what does that look like? Does it look like you're going to work, that you're not going to work, that you're in, what does that look like?
For me, I mean, I kept working and I kept trying to keep up this facade, really, that I can do it all and I'm, you know, amazing at it. But then I became severely depressed over a period of time, and then became even more severe, and I ended up in the hospital twice within a month because I couldn't do it. And so that really showed me and my husband that, you know, we have to change things for my health and for the health of our family.
And now Tara's Closet, so they're taking a big initiative in doing this.
To mark Mental Health Awareness Month, which is in May, we are launching an inaugural mental health event. It's a conversation about compassion and education. And Risa Sugarman will be on our panel along with Dr. Evan Fox and Karen Stahl. And we're bringing in Jenna Bush Hager to start the conversation and stop the stigma of mental illness.
Why Jenna Bush Hager? What's the connection with her?
Well, who doesn't love Jenna Bush Hager?
That's a good connection.
You watch her in the morning. She's relatable. She's personable. She's a mom who works full time, who struggles with all of the same challenges that we do every day. And she is committed to compassion and the power of compassion, giving back, community, making a difference. And that's what Jewish Family Services and Tara's Closet's trying to do, is make a difference and make an impact and help start this conversation. And through members of our community, like Risa Sugarman and Barbara Roth telling their stories, will allow others permission to talk about mental illness.
So these three women, Karen Stahl and Barbara Roth, and of course Risa Sugarman, I mean, this takes a lot of strength. I mean, we're here today because there is a stigma attached. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, we wouldn't be talking about this. Talk about that. How did you decide to come out publicly with this?
I don't think I thought about it, really. It just kind of happened. I had started my own blog when I was going through fertility treatments. And then when I got sick, I continued to write. And I just continued to send out my writing to get published online, and it did. And then it just became a passion almost, because it was very helpful for me personally to write. But then I found out it was really helpful for other people. I started getting contacted from people around the country who read my work and really felt connected to it, that, oh my gosh, this is my experience too, but I'm too afraid to be open about it myself.
So Janice, this can't be a normal situation. I mean, most people aren't coming out publicly with this kind of information.
We're hoping this is the start of the dialogue, so people will come forward. So the stigma will end and people will feel comfortable sharing not only their experience, but their struggles.
Well, we're doing this here in West Hartford and Hartford. Is this conversation happening all over the country, or is this really a JFS initiative? Because I would assume if it's 25% of the adult world, this has got to be happening everywhere. What's happening?
I think you're right. this is our initiative. It is also happening throughout the country, and May is a great month to kick this off and to continue the discussion long after May.
Well, I'm sort of interested in the three women who are coming forward, in Barbara Roth, in Karen Stahl, and in Risa Sugarman. Did you have people wanting to come forward? Did you have more people who said, I want to be part of this? Like, how did we choose these three women? Kim.
Well, we know Risa from the community and have heard her speak at other venues in more smaller, intimate settings. So we were thrilled and delighted when we asked her to speak in front of a room full of 600 people of the community. And I had read an article in The Current about Karen Stahl, who recently published a book with her daughter's poetry. And just like Risa blogged and shares her story that way, her daughter expresses herself through poetry. And she also took her life, and Karen found these poems after she had passed away and gave her some insight as to what was going on inside of her daughter, and decided to publish them and share them with the world.
Now, is this a coincidence? Because Karen Stahl's daughter was a teacher at Kingswood, Oxford, and I understand that Tara also went to Kingswood, Oxford, and your event is at Kingswood, Oxford. Is that a coincidence, or did I just figure this out?
I think it's in Jewish, we call it Besheret.
Besheret.
I think it was kismet that, yes, I think that Tara going to Fordham and Risa getting her master's in social work at Fordham, and Tara is a graduate and alumni of Kingswood Oxford School, which is purposefully why we chose the location and the venue to be at Kingswood in her school. She was very involved at her school. She was the editor of the yearbook. And then Karen, ironically, after reading this article, her story was so, it resonated so much with us, and that her daughter also went to Kingswood and taught at Kingswood.
Her daughter taught at Kingswood and was also a big athlete. She was a coach. I can't remember if it was soccer, but also very, very high functioning people. In fact, you've chosen three very high functioning people. That can't be common, or am I incorrect?
I think it varies. And is that a coincidence certainly we've worked very hard to get the message out, if you would, that we want to take down the barriers so people will feel comfortable about talking and sharing their experiences, much like Risa has done.
So Risa, you shared an experience. I was watching the Dr. Oz segment, and you shared the experience that you went through electroconvulsive therapy, which is very, very controversial. But electroconvulsive therapy is usually just given to people when the medication fails. Mm-hmm. Was that your case?
Yes, it was. We went through months of trying many medications, and either they would have no effect at all, or else I would only feel the side effects. And then it just got to a point where I was severely ill, and I was hospitalized, and we discussed it, and that was kind of my last hope.
So of all the therapies that you've gone through, and I'm sure you've done a lot of them, which are the two therapies that you would say were most successful for Risa Sugarman?
That would definitely be therapy. Talk therapy would be number one, and ECT.
ECT,
electroconvulsive therapy.
Now, are there any side effects for electroconvulsive therapy?
There can be some short-term memory loss.
What does short-term mean?
I may not remember someone's name that I met 3 weeks ago.
So that, again, is what we were talking about. I don't remember someone I met 2 minutes ago.
Mm-hmm.
So
this is kind of it can be kind of a chronic thing, though. So it's more than just a silly, like, oh, I forgot that. It can be very frustrating, especially having a young child, when you want to remember certain things. And at this point, my 7-year-old will remind me. Mommy, write that down because you're going to forget.
Would you recommend, I mean, it's difficult, you're not a clinician, but would you recommend electroconvulsive therapy, given that it's very controversial and given that you have some memory loss? Is that something?
Even with the memory loss, it helped to save my life. I mean, it really does work, and I think what people don't realize, it is extremely safe. It is done very safely. It's not like, you know,
it's not like the movies.
One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest.
Right. With Jack Nicholson.
Yes.
I remember that.
And it's individualized, too. Not everybody gets, it's not one size fits all. It's everybody has their own tapered treatment. So I am a big proponent
that's
of it.
That's very interesting, because most people do remember One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, and most people do remember Jack Nicholson, and they remember this.
Yeah.
And you're saying that's not what
no,
it is.
No, you're under anesthesia. You're out. They put you under, you wake up, you're done.
It's much more gentle than what was depicted in that movie.
Yes.
Wow.
Definitely.
So let's talk about the event. You're going to be at the event. Mm-hmm. That's going to be interesting. It's interesting to me. What's going to happen at the event, Kim?
We have three panelists. The event will be moderated by Dr. Evan Fox, who is at Hartford Hospital and the Institute of Living. And we will have Karen Stahl share her story about her daughter and her struggles with anxiety in the book she recently published with the poetry. And Risa Sugarman will talk about her battles with depression. And then Jenna Bush Hager will address the audience and speak about the power of compassion and giving back in community. And I think it's important to note that mental illness doesn't discriminate. It affects so many people, and everyone can know someone or has been affected themselves by mental illness. So
how many people are you expecting this week? Because you mentioned a few hundred a few minutes ago.
600 people.
600 people. Is there going to be an opportunity for people to talk to one another? Is there going to be that kind of a colloquium?
Yes, well, we will have questions and answers during the program, and then afterwards, our staff at Jewish Family Services, our clinical staff, will be available to answer any questions. If you yourself are maybe thinking that you need some help, or someone you know is struggling and needs some help, and we are a resource in our community, and we serve all. Our name is Jewish Family Services, but we're based on Jewish values to help people in need, and we serve the entire community, men, women, and children, in a comprehensive family unit. So we serve everyone, and it impacts the entire family. It doesn't just impact the person who's being affected by mental illness. It's your children, your spouse, your parents, your colleagues. Everyone is impacted by it.
So how's that going to look? Is there going to be a keynote speaker at Jenna Hager Bush? It's going to be at Roberts Theater.
Yes.
May the 11th.
Mm-hmm. Thursday, May 11th.
Thursday, May the 11th, 7 p.m. Mm-hmm. And then we're going to have a panel discussion. Mm-hmm. And then after the panel discussion, will you have little breakout sessions with different clinicians? Or how's that going to work?
Not for this year, we will not. That's a great idea, and we've talked about doing that annually. So next year we'll have more, but the clinicians will be available at the end of the program to listen, to talk with people about their concerns, maybe to go into a separate room if people wanted to share something that they didn't want to share with the whole group. And we have a group, a team of clinicians with expertise that is amazing. We have a very skilled group of therapists.
Is there the mental health illness, you know, is this more common now than it was? Are there some sort of statistics, like in the year 2017? Is there more problems?
There are more problems. In the New York Times about 2 weeks ago, there was something about teen death, and now it's at the same rate as traffic accidents.
So it's risen.
Significant. And mental health issues in girls has increased. It's really tripled. And part of that, they believe, is because of social media and Facebook and Instagram. Used to be if you wrote a note to somebody and you passed it, either the teacher took it away or it was ripped up and forgotten. Now it's out there forever. And it's shared in the community, and it's a huge problem. So for women and for boys, girls and boys, it's generated not just some recognition, but everyone's weaknesses are right out in the forefront.
Right, you have a spotlight on them. So one last question, Teresa. Because this is a heroic thing that you're doing, that you're coming out front. It's not common, it's heroic. Do you have anything that you want to say?
I just think that people are afraid of what they don't know or what they don't understand. And unfortunately, mental illness falls into that category if people aren't familiar with it, or it frightens them. And my hope is that people will become more comfortable hearing about it more, hearing people's, you know, their personal stories, and people will want to learn more. And people are compassionate by nature. And I think that if they have a better understanding of mental illness, it's going to become more of our daily conversations and our daily jargon.
So I've been talking to Risa Sugarman, Kim Margolis, and Janice Rothstein. The event, the big event, is going to take place on May the 11th, 7 p.m., Roberts Theater. Jenna Hager Bush is going to be the keynote speaker. And this is a topic that affects everybody. There's 600 spaces. Fill those spaces, because those 600 people will affect 5-6 times the amount of people who are going to be at that event. It's an important thing to do. It's an important initiative. Let's all support JFS and Tara's Closet. I'm Pat Kazikoff. See you there.